God told Jonah to go to Nineveh and tell them that their sin had come up before God and their destruction would occur in 40 days. Jonah had fled on a boat, but the storm was such that the sailors cast him overboard. He was captured in the mouth of a great fish, and that fish vomited up onto land. And then in chapter 3, he goes into Nineveh, tells Nineveh that their sin has come up before the Lord, and the Ninevites repent of their sin, and they fast, and they sit in sackcloth and ashes, and they seek the Lord, hoping that God might relent from the judgment that is going to come. And Jonah chapter 3 ends this way. God relented of the disaster that he was going to do to them, and he did not do it. And that is what ends chapter 3. And chapter 4, it says, it displeased Jonah exceedingly that God relented from the destruction he planned for Nineveh. Okay, so the two sections of Jonah chapter 4. The first section is the first four verses, and it's Jonah's dissatisfaction with God and his response to God because God had relented from the disaster he was going to bring on the people of Nineveh. So Jonah was displeased. What was Jonah displeased about? He was displeased with what God was doing with the people of Nineveh. He was so mad that he wanted God to put him to death. The way it's worded here in Jonah chapter 4, verse 1, is Jonah is saying that what God did or what God chose not to do to Nineveh was evil. In fact, it's the same word. The word that God said, look, the evil of the Ninevites has come up before me. Jonah is now, in a sense, saying the evil that God has done has come up before me, Jonah, and he was displeased. So Jonah, in a sense here, is accusing God of being as evil as the people of Nineveh. That's how angry he is with the Lord here. He is so mad with God because he feels now God is a party to the sins of Nineveh. And Jonah considers God evil in the same way that God considered Nineveh evil. So Jonah and God both agreed that what Nineveh was doing beforehand was evil. Most people would have agreed with it. They were a very violent culture. However, now that God has forgiven Nineveh, Jonah is upset and he is accusing God of being a party to the evil of the Ninevites. If we give Jonah the absolute benefit of the doubt, the best we can say about Jonah is he was mad that God used him to deliver the Ninevites, that God would have Jonah participate in this happening. At worst, we would suggest Jonah, in fact, is displaying a sense of hatred toward God that he would save the Ninevites. It's hard to tell. The Bible doesn't tell us the motivations of Jonah or what's going on in his heart. But at the very least, he was angry to be a part of God's plan to save the Ninevites. At worst, Jonah is now filled with an intense hatred of God. Look how Jonah describes God in verse 2 of Jonah 4. Lord, isn't this what I said when I was still in my country, and that is Israel? In fact, he says this, that's why I fled to Tarshish instead of going to Nineveh, for I knew, and listen to how he describes what he knows is true of God. I knew that you are a gracious God, you are merciful, you are slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Jonah said, I knew something about you, God, that if these people repented, that you would forgive them. And Jonah wanted none of it. He didn't want the Ninevites to receive God's grace and God's forgiveness. And so that's why he fled to Tarshish. Isn't that interesting? He fled to Tarshish not because God is spiteful and angry and harsh. He fled to Tarshish because he knew God was forgiving. And the last thing he wanted the people of Nineveh to experience was God's forgiveness. God then asks Jonah a question which is going to reveal to us what God's plan is as he's going to try and teach Jonah an object lesson. The Lord said this, do you do well to be angry? So this is a question God is asking Jonah to try and get him to consider his own heart and his own motivations. And as you can tell from our reading of the book of Jonah here, Jonah isn't terribly interested in evaluating his own heart condition. What God wants Jonah to look at is his own heart and say, why are you angry? And here's why Jonah was angry. He wanted the Ninevites to be judged. He didn't like the Ninevites. He didn't like their violence and their sin. He didn't like that they weren't connected with temple worship the way the people of Israel were. He didn't like what one commentator suggested this, that Jonah's prophetic ministry in Israel was probably not terribly effective. Jonah was alive during the reign of King Jeroboam II, and this was a time of great evil in the lives of the people of the northern 10 tribes of Israel. And so likely Jonah was a prophet in Israel, and very likely nobody was listening to him because nobody in the northern tribes of Israel cared about God at all. So Jonah's preaching and his prophesying is mostly ineffective in Israel. He goes to Nineveh, preaches an 8-word sermon, and the entire city repents and believes the Lord. And he's upset because, number one, the Ninevites are going to receive forgiveness, and the people of Israel are going to continue to be under judgment because they are rejecting the Lord. He doesn't like Nineveh because he knows they are violent and will likely invade Israel at some point because they're building their military strength during this time. So Jonah didn't like anything about Nineveh. It wasn't just merely he didn't like the people of Nineveh. We could say it this way, and it's going to sound harsh, but it's true. Jonah wanted the people of Nineveh to go to hell. He didn't want them to have a relationship with God. He wanted them to experience eternal judgment. He did not want God's mercy extended to the people of Nineveh. And that's hard for us to believe, but that's exactly where his heart was. He didn't want the people of Nineveh to experience salvation. And now he had a problem, not with the people of Nineveh. Now he has a problem with God. What is God like if he would save a people like that? And Jonah's argument is this. If God would save the people of Nineveh, there's something wrong with God. Now, there's something interesting about Jonah here that offers an interesting contrast to our modern-day notions of the view of God. We tend to look at God, and we not merely Christians, but I mean our culture broadly, we want to define God according to terms that fit our understanding of the world around us. And so we will think, whatever I want my life to look like, my assumption will be that if there is a God, then that God must be in some ways approving of the way my life is. Because God, for the most part, is a creation, in our culture anyway, of our mind. Jonah shows us actually one important thing that's good to note. He has a very biblical view of God, which is this. God is who he is, and we have to decide whether we like it or not. He is not going to conform himself to our notions of what ought to be. God is, and we either accept that and seek relationship with him, or reject that and experience what judgment will come for separating ourselves from God. Jonah is not arguing that God should change, notice. Jonah is not arguing that God should try and do things differently. Jonah understands how God works. He is God, and he is going to do things the way he's going to do them. Jonah is merely stating what's true. He doesn't like it. He doesn't like how God is doing things, and the only argument he has from his perspective is to tell God he doesn't like what is happening. And what he doesn't like is God's forgiveness and grace for a people like Nineveh. Okay, let's move to the second section, and we're going to look at God's object lesson to Jonah. Knowing his perspective now from the first four verses, Jonah's response to what God did in the city of Nineveh, God is now going to work to provide an object lesson to Jonah. So we're going to work our way through this object lesson, and then at the end of the object lesson, we'll go through, and I've got, it looks like 8 or 9 different implications of the realities of this chapter that really will line up with what you and I think about on a day-in and day-out basis. So, Jonah went out of the city, and he sat to the east of the city, and he made himself a booth. This part of the world, Nineveh would have been on the northern part of the Assyrian kingdom, and just think of where the land of Israel is. Go east just a hair and go north just a hair. So this particular area is very arid. It is known for these very hot, very dry winds. The median temperature year-round is over 100 degrees. And so it would have been very uncomfortable to sit outdoors. So he goes outside of the city and builds himself a booth. And it says he wants to see what is going to happen to the city. He wants to observe what's going to happen to us, to the city. Two things could happen to the city. Number one, God could destroy the city. And that's probably what he's hoping happens. He hopes that God maybe has paid attention to his complaint, and God is now going to reconsider his grace and pour judgment out on the city. And then Jonah will say, look, God, okay, you got it right, God. Good for you. Congratulations. Thanks for rejoining the good team. And so Jonah is watching to see what happens. But more than likely, Jonah is sitting there to watch nothing happen to the city to confirm what he already knows. God is who he is, and Jonah just doesn't like how God operates. And so he's going there to confirm in his own mind that God is, in fact, as disappointing as he thought he was, to, in fact, justify why he fled on the ship. See, God, I knew what would happen. You wouldn't judge the city. So Jonah went out of the city. He built himself a booth. As a Jewish man, he would have been very familiar with building these booths as a part of the temple worship. They would have gone out once a year to the temple, and they would have built booths to remind them of their transition from Egypt to the Promised Land in the wilderness. And he probably built a booth very similar to what he would have built during the Feast of Tabernacles or the Feast of Booths. So he built this city, this booth, to provide himself some shade. And look what God does in verse 6. The Lord God appointed a plant. Okay, just take a break for a minute here as we're working through the wording of this. That phrase there, God appointed, is going to happen a couple more times in this passage, showing us God's personal, intimate involvement in what is going on in every facet of Jonah's experience here in this last chapter. God appointed a plant, and he made it grow up over Jonah in order to provide shade for Jonah's head and to save him from his discomfort. And the end of verse 6 says, Jonah was very glad about the plant. How fast did the plant grow? It doesn't matter. The plant clearly is a miraculous plant from God. It could have grown overnight. God appointed it to grow overnight. Or it could have grown over the course of days or a couple of weeks, because the judgment of Nineveh was said to be 40 days out. And so Jonah might have planned on sitting in his shade booth for 40 days to see if God's judgment would come in 40 days. Or the plant could have grown overnight. It really doesn't matter, because the Bible is quite clear. The growth of this plant is a miracle. God grows it to provide shade over his head, to provide comfort for Jonah. And why is God wanting to comfort Jonah? Is it because he's concerned about his exposure to the sun and to the wind? No. He is preparing Jonah for the object lesson that is about to come. Jonah was very glad about this plant. So God made a plant to grow, and what God wanted to do was have Jonah respond favorably to the plant. Okay, now look what's happened. The next day, God appointed a worm. He found a worm, and he said, go and eat this plant and kill it. Again, we can compare and contrast the worm with Jonah. When God told Jonah to go to the Ninevites, what did Jonah do? Jonah rebelled and fled to the city of Tarshish, or at least tried to. When God told the worm to go and eat the plant, what did the worm do? It went and ate the plant. So everything in here is to show us Jonah's heart is the one that's twisted in this narrative. So a worm attacked the plant, and the plant withered. Okay, God's going to appoint now, verse 8, when the sun rose, God appointed a scorching east wind. So God had appointed a plant so that Jonah might respond favorably to the plant. God appointed a worm to kill that worm. Then God appointed the wind to increase the suffering Jonah was experiencing under the sun. Why is the wind important there? Well, he had a little booth built that provided him some protection from the sun, but a little booth built with branches and leaves is not going to protect him from these scorching east winds that kick up with all the sand and debris kicking into his little booth there. The sun beat down on him to a degree that Jonah finally became faint, and Jonah begged God to take his life. And God says this to Jonah to bring full circle the plant that God had appointed for Jonah. God said this, "Do you do well to be angry about the plant?" And he's not here judging Jonah's anger. He wants to make a point to Jonah about the fondness he had for the plant. And Jonah responded. He fell right into God's logical trap. He said, "Yes, I have a right to be angry about the plant. In fact, I am so angry and upset about the plant that I would die." And then God makes his point to Jonah to try and get Jonah to see the people of Nineveh the way God sees the people of Nineveh. God says this, "You pity that plant. You didn't work to get the plant to grow. You didn't water it. You didn't create it. It came into being in a night and perished in a night." So he's saying you had fondness for this plant that you did not create, that you did not make grow, and it was there one day and gone the next day. So what he's saying is you had fondness for a thing that really had no value and you had no investment in. So then God comes around, he makes his point to Jonah in verse 11. If you could pity and be upset about the death of this plant, should I not pity Nineveh? What he did was he wanted Jonah to have fondness for a plant so that he could show Jonah that at minimum God should have fondness for the people of Nineveh. Because God made the people of Nineveh, because Jonah would have known, being a good Jewish prophet and understanding the Pentateuch and the book of Genesis, God created the whole world and every single person in it. And God is saying, I created the plant, I created every person, I created the Ninevites. Should I not have a fondness for the people of Nineveh at minimum the way you have a fondness for the plant? He's trying here to just get Jonah to think. Think, Jonah, anything you have made, don't you have a fondness for it? Why is it so hard to imagine, God is saying to Jonah, that I might have a fondness for the people of Nineveh, even in their sin, because they are of my handiwork? He says, look at this city. There's 120,000 people there who don't know the right from their left, meaning they have no moral guidance at all. Not only that, there's livestock in the city. That should all of the livestock and all of these people be destroyed with no second thought? And the book of Jonah ends. We have no idea how Jonah responded. We have no idea whether Jonah understood the object lesson or whether he accepted it or whether he just continued to reject it and live in anger and displeasure towards God. So God makes this important point that we don't know if Jonah accepted or not, which is this. All of the world is my handiwork, and my nature is one that is going to seek redemption for my handiwork, people made in my image. And Jonah is made to understand he cared more about the vine than the people of Nineveh, and God's point is this. I care about the people of Nineveh in the same way that you cared about your vine. They are my people that I have made, and I would seek for their salvation if they would have it. So actually, God's argument to Jonah is very, very logical. Just like you might say to any of us, we say, well, how could God love the people of Nineveh? And God's argument to us is, have you ever planted a garden and tended it and kept the weeds out and fertilized it and pruned the plants so that they might yield the greatest amount of fruit? If we have any sense of connection to that working of our hands in the garden, then we should at minimum understand how God views every single person who's ever lived, because God has made every single person who has ever lived. So Jonah's response to God's nature is anger and displeasure, and God's response to Jonah is to try and get Jonah to see things from God's perspective. The hatred he has for Nineveh is not something that God has for the people of Nineveh. Okay, let's go through a couple of things by way of summary here for the last 4 or 5, maybe 6 minutes. I've got 8, maybe 9 sort of implications from this chapter in the book of Jonah that should help us to understand God and should help us to understand how, since we know something about God here, what should that mean for each one of us? First of all, when we look at the people of Nineveh, this should be a tremendous encouragement for every single one of us who understand we're sinners. God is indeed merciful. If we understand God is the way Jonah described him, God is looking for reasons to be merciful, not reasons to be judgmental or spiteful. And we as religious people, Christians especially, growing up in this time period, we tend to assume that God's viewpoint is one where he's sitting in heaven just waiting for us to mess up so that he can give us the strong backhand and knock us off our rocker. That God is just waiting for us to mess up so that he can blast us. And if the book of Jonah tells us anything about God at all, it tells us the opposite is true. He is sitting on the edge of his seat, anticipating his next opportunity to display his great mercy to us. It's not to say that we should sin in order to experience God's mercy. However, since we do still sin, and the Bible makes it quite clear, all of us sin. Since we do still sin, we should be willing to be somewhat even audacious to experience the mercy of God and recognize, not that we want to continue sinning, but that when we do, God pours out his mercy, and he is looking forward to the opportunity for his mercy to be expressed to us. Okay, second thing we have here. The Ninevites is an encouragement to all of us who are sinners or still struggle with sin is that God is indeed merciful. It's his nature. Jonah understood that clearly. All right, the next thing I want us to think about is how we read the Bible. And we need to be reminded about how to read the Bible properly. Many of us read the Bible looking for examples we should follow. And so we look at a different character. We look at Moses, and we look at David, and we look at Joshua, and we look at Aaron, and we look at Solomon, and we look at King Jehoshaphat and King Josiah, and we look at all these characters in the Bible, maybe even the New Testament, Peter, James, and John. Obviously, Jesus is our greatest example. And how we tend to read the Bible is we look for examples of people we should emulate and copy them. And to some degree, that's true, but we need to be a little bit more discerning. We are to emulate and copy the way people behave when they recognize they need redemption. Not necessarily the way they behave generally, because we know everyone in the Bible, other than Jesus himself, had significant personal flaws that ought not to be emulated. And when we look at the book of Jonah, we shouldn't say, well, how should we copy Jonah? There is very little in the book of Jonah that we should emulate. There is only one example that we ought to emulate, and it's not the prophet Jonah, it's the people of Nineveh. And how do we copy? How do we imitate the people of Nineveh? We recognize our sin, and we recognize God saves sinners when we turn to him, not because we turn to him, but because he is merciful. And when we read the Bible, we should be reading it through, not always looking for good behavior to copy. Really, for the most part, we should be reading through it and discovering examples of how do sinners repent? How do sinners overcome their sin? The life of David is filled with that. And he has a number of occasions where he sins, where his repentance is a fantastic example to us. His sin with Bathsheba, of course, is one. But probably an even greater example of it is near the end of his life when he takes a census of Israel, and he is conscience-stricken even before God shows up. So he counts Israel, and even before the prophet Gad shows up to tell David how bad his actions were, his conscience strikes him before God shows up and confronts him. His conscience is stricken, and he confesses his sin before he's caught. He recognizes what he has done is wrong, and he confesses it. The prophet Gad shows up and says, you're right, God agrees with you. What you did was terribly wrong. You should not have taken a census. And he has given some offer. He is told this. God gives you three options for what is going to happen as a result of your sin. You can face 3 years of famine, you can be pursued by your enemies, or you can face 3 days of plague. And what's interesting about David's response to Gad, he doesn't really pick one of those. This is what he says to Gad, which is a great example to us in repentance. He says this, listen, I will throw myself into the hands of God, but not into people. And why does he say that? Because I know God is merciful. And so 3 days of plague come, but God even forestalls the plague before it is finally completed. So the examples we read about in Scripture that we should really be latching onto is, what do repenters look like? What do confessors look like? What does it look like to throw myself at the mercy of God? And that occurs throughout the Scripture. And here in Jonah, we see a great example of that in the people of Nineveh, whose sin we couldn't have, it would make us blush if we knew what was going on there. They threw themselves on the mercy of God, and God responded according to his nature, and he offered them forgiveness. Okay, next implication we need to understand in looking at the relationship between Jonah and Nineveh and God and Jonah's understanding of grace, and I think this is something that is universally true. It's something we have in common with Jonah, and the sooner we admit to it, the sooner we can begin to address it in our own life by the grace of God, and it's this. Number of things. We think we don't need as much grace as we actually need. If we understood how much grace God actually was giving to us and how much we actually needed, we'd be very surprised. We misunderstand grace because we agree, well, we need grace. What we don't understand is how much grace we actually need. So the first thing we misunderstand about grace is how much grace each one of us needs, meaning we don't really truly understand the depths of our sinfulness. Secondly, when others seem to me need more grace than us. So we know we need grace, and we look at the person next to us, their sin, in our mind at least, is worse than us, and so it appears to us they need more grace than us. We find it offensive that God would be willing to forgive someone who does things such as that. So we agree we need grace, but first of all, we understate how much grace we need. Like Jonah said, certainly he would have said, oh yeah, I need forgiveness, that's why I go to the temple. But then he looks at the grace offered to the Ninevites and he said, whoa, 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 simmer down, God. That's going overboard. That is going a little beyond what we ought to do. And all of us do this. We say, oh, sure, I need grace. I don't need as much grace, though, as you might think. And the fact that God would offer that much grace to this person who sins this way, we find that offensive. And in our hearts, if God would forgive somebody like that, we then might accuse God and saying, God, why would you let them get away with something like that? Continuing on this same point, we find grace acceptable for everyone who we might perceive needs grace at the same way we do, for the same kinds of sins that we need it. We're okay with people receiving grace for the kinds of sins we struggle with or the kinds of sins we find in our history. And we're okay with people who need grace less than us. Like, I'm okay with somebody who needs less grace than me because they're a much better person than me. They certainly need grace, but they don't need as much as me. We find it acceptable for people to receive grace who sin like we do. Or we find it acceptable for people to receive the grace of God who are, in our minds anyway, we perceive as better than us, well-behaved than us. On the other hand, we find grace distasteful for those who sin worse than us, who struggle with sin worse than us. We say, well, God should give me grace for my bad attitude because he sees I'm really working on it. Why is God giving grace for this guy's bad attitude? He's not even trying to get better. And we find that offensive. And so then we accuse God. God, you should judge this person. Why is everything going so well for this person who is clearly taking advantage of your grace? That's just a Jonah attitude. We're okay with people needing grace like us or people who need grace less than us, at least in our minds. Biblically, we all need all of God's grace. But when we see somebody receiving grace who sins much worse than us and doesn't even seem like they're trying to get over it, boy, that bothers us. Okay, one more issue on this grace thing that I want to point out. We find grace acceptable for everybody who sins when their sin doesn't affect us. So I'm okay if you do something wrong and God gives you gives grace to you as long as what you did doesn't affect me. However, we find grace offensive that God would forgive somebody for what they did when what they did had such a negative impact on my life. And that is a key issue with Jonah. He knows the Ninevites, their violence, are a real threat to the people of Israel. God, I'm okay with you offering grace to people on the other side of the world. But offering grace to sinners like that who are a threat, that's not fair, God. And that's the way we act. We say, well, God should certainly forgive me, and he should certainly forgive the guy across the street that I never talked to, but you're going to forgive my family member who did something that harmed me financially? You're going to forgive my family member who said something that ruined my reputation? You're going to forgive my friend who took advantage of me financially? You're going to forgive my Christian boss who fired me and laid me off for no reason? And now we're offended at God that he would offer grace to someone whose sin affected us. And we get deeply offended by that. And this is where Jonah struggled with. And the reality of this is, if we agree that God is gracious and merciful, he is gracious and merciful even to sinners who sin against us. Even to sinners who do things that offend us. Okay, three more things, and then we're going to get then we're going to wrap it up. Think of all the things that we might grieve. We might grieve losses. We might grieve financial losses. We might grieve friendships that have broken up. We might grieve relationships that have fallen apart. We might grieve looking at the world situation and conflict and those kind of things. And this is what we learn about God in the Scripture. God grieves the lost who need mercy more than anything you and I might grieve. So think of your worst loss that you have experienced. God grieves lost who have not experienced his mercy greater than our greatest loss. And he also presumes that we ought to grieve the lost in the same manner he does. So what God is looking at is his greatest grief, that his greatest heart-rending sadness comes from seeing lost sinners who have not experienced his mercy. His assumption is when we're pursuing a relationship with him, we would grieve the lost in the same manner he does. But the fact is, and this is why we need to think about it, like Jonah, we don't always grieve the lost in that way. In fact, like Jonah, we say, well, listen, they've rejected God. They're going to get what they deserve. And that cavalier attitude is very different than God's attitude towards the lost. He grieves the lost without mercy the way you and I have grieved some of our greatest losses. All right, two more things. Jonah is good. The book of Jonah, generally, not the guy Jonah. The book of Jonah is good news for Ninevites or people like the Ninevites. The book of Jonah is good news for sinners who need grace and mercy. The book of Jonah is a good news for both believers and non-believers who say, I recognize my life doesn't line up to God's way. I'm going to just simply throw myself on the mercy of God and let his mercy be the definition of my relationship with him. So the book of Jonah is good news for Ninevites. So if you read the Bible and you say, you know what, I'm a Ninevite. My life is one that of an ongoing struggle with sin. The book of Jonah is good news for you. However, the book of Jonah is bad news for religious people who think they have their act together. Because the greatest flaw in the book of Jonah is a religious person who is good enough. And the fact is, a merciful God is not useful to a religious person seeking to be good. A religious person seeking to be good does not want a merciful God. He wants a cold-hearted, judgmental God. So God would be play favorites with the religious person and reject all who aren't like him. So the book of Jonah is good news for those of us who sin like Ninevites. The book of Jonah is really bad news for those of us who think we can be good enough and religious enough and God should be on our team. God appoints a plant to give us comfort and takes it away as religious people that we might have our attitude adjusted to see what his heart yearns for. Okay, last thing. In Scripture, we're going to see God most accurately, most clearly, most profoundly when we read it recognizing we're Ninevites. We're going to encounter the Scripture most profoundly and encounter God in our hearts most significantly when we read it as those who need God's mercy. We encounter God's grace most vividly as a Ninevite, not as a religious Jonah. So if you're reading the Bible and looking for the six things you're supposed to do right today or the six sins you're supposed to say no to today, You're going to be reading your Bible like a religious Jonah, and you're going to be living today trying at the end of the day to tell God you did it good enough. But if you read it like a Ninevite, you're going to realize how merciful God is, and you're going to live today in freedom. And at the end of the day, when your head hits the pillow, you're going to say, God, thank you for your mercy again today, because I blew it again today, and your mercy was new again today. One of the reasons scripture reading becomes very dull for us is because somehow we have lost sense of our need for mercy. When we understand our need for mercy, we read the book of Jonah as Ninevites, and we say, God, you would really save somebody like me? And God, you would continue to hold on to somebody like me? God, you are full of mercy, and you are full of grace. All right, that concludes our study for today in the book of Jonah. And like I say, it concludes our study for Tuesdays, at least for the summer. There is a study tomorrow with Pat on how to read your Bible. I'm grateful to have had you with us throughout these studies, and I look forward to having more times of study with you. Let's close in prayer and give this time to the Lord. God, we pray that you would just impress on us the profound nature of your great mercy. Thank you, God, for your love for us, and that we experience your mercy because Jesus came and died for us. And that shows us how much you love sinners like us. God, would you allow us to rest in the mercy you give and recognize the yoke you give us is easy and light. And you say, to those of us who are weary and heavy laden, come to you and give us rest. So God, allow us to experience the rest of your mercy today. And we pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thanks for being with us today. We'll see you next time. God bless.